Thank you for the introduction, and a big thank you to Sapien Labs for putting this on, as well as to those who have taken the time to exchange of ideas. The whole idea of this conference is a lot of the thrust of the work I've done, in the sense that we often, as you were just saying, you look at one size fits all, and the human brain tells us anything. It tells us about variability. What I'm also going to hopefully really give examples of, not just from sport, but I think we can see this in a lot of environments. My professional experience, I am a practitioner, a researcher, and an educator. And a lot of the environments I've found myself in sport, tactical, and aerospace, has been to address questions of a new way. And this is where I think there's a lot of crossover with other environments. Often in traditional sport, and I do work around the world, but I'll let you know when I'm speaking more North American centric, and when I'm speaking, give examples from elsewhere in the world. But particularly in North America and the US, we proceed with one size fits all, in the sense of athlete development, learning, and training. We also can see this, all of us who are listening are either pursuing some academic pursuit, are involved with an environment that inspires us to continue to grow, that it's, and that's very individual. But we see in education often this one size fits all as well, and we can see the same in industry, really not accounting for the human differences right down to the central nervous system. So some of the remits of the environments I've been in have been focused very much on developing a brain first model that accounts for a individual way of protecting talent and developing talent. And with a brain first model, one of the pieces that's often not thought about is measurement from the brain, but also not so much training, or we can talk about education or work in industry, but the glue that puts those things together is recovery. Training, education, work is nothing but stimulation. But without recovery, they don't come together. And so I have the great pleasure of working in team science, transdisciplinary environments in which we're trying to address some of the most complex questions of health and human performance related to individuality. What I hope to cover, and certainly exchange, hopefully there's questions along the way, so what does North American model look like? And it can mirror some other places in the world. Some examples that are very, very different are places where I get to collaborate, which is Australia. They don't have the population, so they have to develop athletes and protect talent. But we'll talk about what's the current model. And again, this model often fits academics as well and industry. Then looking at prevention. So how do we protect talent from a brain first and not ignoring, you know, the 11 other systems that the brain certainly runs. Then looking at the concept of readiness and how do we measure that and what are the multiple ways. And then a concept that gets confused a lot because it's been called a lot of different things in the literature. And primarily, I'll go into a little bit of the history of it, came from the Soviet bloc country, adding to the difficulty of getting that information because they don't translate the research into English. And then how human resilience is something that is not remarkable, actually. It is normal, it is actually attainable, and it is part of our neurophysiology and our survival system of our brain. And then looking at how does timing and dosing matter when we talk about training or education or work or workload. So I'll try to touch on that. And again, focused on sport, but I think there's a lot of environments that fit. So if we look at the current model in North America, we have a great opportunity because we have some of the largest population in the world, not larger than China, but part of the largest population and also the most diverse. What we talk about from a genetic standpoint and from a diversity standpoint, again, the thrust of this whole conference is variability, the rule, not the exception. But unfortunately, due to having a large population and very few high-level individuals working in sports science and sports medicine with a focus on protecting talent and developing talent. In the United States, we end up injuring more athletes than we do developing them. This is a very different model. It's an attrition model. But from a brain-first standpoint, we can see we're not attending to variability of training load, education, learning, and then adaptation. Where I hinted towards, I have the opportunity of being in Australia. Since the Montreal Olympics in 1976, they have adopted a model of protecting talent and developing it, because they don't have the population to actually be able to break athletes and then provide national teams or provide competitive environments. And so they have adopted the Australian Institute of Sport model, which is a prevention model and a development model. So currently, when I'm working in North America, I find myself in unique spaces, because we're not looking at protecting talent and the variability of how individuals learn. For instance, learning happens in a classroom, but it also has to happen in the fields and the courts and the ice rinks of sport. But when we don't evaluate that diversity and how people engage with information, how they load stimulus of growing cardiac ability or neuromuscular or changing endocrine or neuroanatomy of processing, concentration, attention, those sort of things, we are not developing athletes. We're just seeing who will survive. One of the also prevalent things that really kind of pervades North American sport and elsewhere in the world are mental toughness and grit, these prevailing theories. However, and I could do a whole talk on these sort of unfortunate theories, because they are fueled by the illusion that they seem to make sense, the illusion of validity. And they're fueled by belief bias, that we want them so desperately to be true that complex things come down to simple factors, when human health and human performance is a sum of many parts. And complexity is a part of that. And actually, no part of it is separate from the brain in that process. Another way to look at mental toughness and grit is that they really do not account for the psychophysiology, neurophysiology, the factors of the central nervous system. They are not describing the underlying process, but we believe we can identify people. They make extraordinary claims, but don't offer up the extraordinary evidence. Mental toughness is a concept that's been around since 1982 and really was just a concept that was rebranded. Grit was as well. And that really falls for what Kelly would call the Jangle fallacy, the belief that two things with different names are suddenly different concepts. They're not. And so this is the world I find myself working in. And so that the brain is often forgotten and most things are neck down. But in the environments I have had the opportunity of working with that were willing to be innovative and look at it for a different way, from protecting talent, the return on investment, if you will, but I would see it more as human dignity, that there's an opportunity there to really protect talent and develop it. And the concepts that we really work with in these environments are prevention modeling. So when we know when there's not a cure, prevention is going to save us time, save us energy, but also save individuals for them to continue on their journey of being able to develop. And certainly that middle image is something that I often find that is left out of science in general. Complex systems and nonlinear analysis. That's why I have a great respect for physics and mathematics. Physicists have to try to understand the nature of the nature. They're not doing extractions and starting to look at things in reductionistic ways. And so we have applied in environments that I've been in with the elite military and elite sport has been nonlinear. Try to understand the nature of the nature. Control is an illusion. How can we manage? And what factors mathematically and from the central nervous system can we understand down to the individual? And then that last picture really referencing the central nervous system, as sport is generally neck down. And that is something I've had great joy in being able to work in team environments to demonstrate to other disciplines like exercise physiology that to answer these questions, we all got to work together. No one discipline will have the answer. But taking these concepts and then building them into a process in which we can understand the individual and then understand a process for them and then bring that to an organizational process. What I might add in here too is my work is not just with athletes. Well, I think we often forget that we're all performers. And so a lot of my work has been with coaches because they're often sport coaches. They're often ignored, and their health metrics lead to failures in their ability and judgment or emotional management, which leading to judgment in critical moments. But then also we know about the vicarious trauma among those who support certain environments. And so looking at supporting medical staff and sport science staff and those sort of things, because it's a complex system. And so looking at those nonlinear factors and again, applying them forward. To touch on one thing too that relates to this as a neck down process, often in sport and in health, we refer to subjective realities of stress, but they are subjective, where the brain really only interprets trauma and survival. Is it a small T or a big T? So in the environment, starting to look at when we are training individuals, what is the timing and dosing? And we'll get into that a little bit later, but since I mentioned that term, I certainly wanted to clarify it up front. So for me and the teams I work with, we look at CNS readiness and measurement as a critical factor. The brain, in that illustration, runs 11 systems. And running 11 systems, you can measure independently those other systems, the cardiac, the endocrine, the neuromuscular. But what we're missing is the governor of it all. You know, the brain always wins. It is what runs things. And when we're not attending to that, we're really missing some viable information about readiness. An athlete or a performer can be prepared, but are they ready? And to give some simple examples of that probably all of us have experienced, I'll give one example that I think all of us have, is preparing for an exam in our academic journey or at some point in our career, and we go in and we draw a blank. And we may have been prepared, but were we ready to manage the situation? If from a brain first perspective, that emotions run the show in sport and life. And, you know, and talking more about DC potential, although we're looking at the top of the brain, much of my work is also looking at the bottom. We conflate a bit of the top of the brain when actually nothing passes through to get to the neocortex, except when it passes through the lower brain. And that has to do with emotional management and physiology and neurophysiology. Vagus nerve response, breath rate, these sort of things. And so they're so important to be looking at. But so with that example we've all experienced, in sport it would be different. Athlete shows up for practice and we don't know unless we measure, and this is another thing that happens in sport that I think it happens in other industries as well. We want to believe that we can see everything with our eyes, and we cannot. It is just an inference is what we see of our eyes. And so when an athlete shows up, being able to measure what are they ready for, what type of dosing of training, whether we talk about endurance or sprinting, or we talk about strength, what are they ready for? And the same can be in academics. The same could be in industry. Really seeing what the person is primed for, which leads to further questions too. What is their rest cycles? What can we do today with them? What's their trajectory of learning? But because we don't do a lot of objective and subjective measurement, we're guessing. And where that means we're guessing with human potential. But some of the areas I would measure would be DC potential. So as I said, it is known as other terms often as steady potential, you know, slow cortical potentials, infraslow cortical potentials, ultra slow cortical potentials, and this leads to some of the people not knowing this concept, but then when you get all the other definitions of it or ways in which it's been referred to, people are like, okay, I do understand this. And this came out of the Russians during the space race. It's as old as 1930. The understanding of DC potential was actually hiding right in front of us. EEG is not DC current, it's AC current. Evaluating DC led us to other information. But during the space race, the Russians had to figure out when a cosmonaut would be ready. You're putting them on a very expensive apparatus, you know, billions of dollars in today's money and maybe even more than that. And they couldn't use normal physiological heart rate, some sort of test looking at VO2 max, a wind gate test. They couldn't look at traditional testing. And they started to see that this had, no pun intended or pun intended, potential to be able to understand the individual's readiness to handle attention, focus, and as certainly Michael Posner has talked about and many of us can experience, and if we don't have attention, then nothing else really lines up. And certainly it has inferences of strong connections to the lower center of the brain. So I'll measure DC potential. And so what am I measuring is millivolts. We're measuring a normal values between 0 and 46 millivolts. And so when someone's not, when they have central nervous system fatigue, they're at a 0 or below, negative numbers. In fact, I'll use DC potential in concussion. But is there variability there? Absolutely. We're measuring the individual and gaining data on how to work with that individual. Often people will measure HRV and conflate it as a brain measure. It is, there is some inference there, but it's more an autonomic nervous system measure, which is helpful when understanding readiness. But without looking at the central drive signals, we're really, there's a gap there in information. But we'll also collect, you know, heart rate, resting heart rate. Optic flow is actually the amount of information a person can take in, and certainly through the visual systems, which take quite a bit of energy. Then we'll look at multiple object tracking. That is basically working memory and how much can I understand in my environment and track and then predict off of that. And then reaction time. And then certainly we can look at cortisol. We can look at other measures through the blood, biomechanical movement, which again, brain-derived, and then neuromuscular flexion, as well as adaptation of movement. The other thing I don't have on here we would look at too is urine, blood, and fecal matter, looking at gut-brain access. Research is still, we're growing with that, but it gives a more complete picture because when an athlete is not ready, they tend to flush serotonin out of their gut-brain access. And so we're really, when we're working with athletes, we understand them as an individual in these factors. But then also to not ignore the subjective experience. This is where data is very, very helpful because when we're training people in any environment, we're also training interception or neuroception. What do my emotions mean? So the data is not just for the scientist. It's for the coaches to how to load them, but it's for the athletes to understand their neurophysiology signals so they can understand how they do things. And also in this, in our conversation here, is how is the best way to be ready? How is the best way to recover and rest? So DC potential, as I said, the history is really from the Soviet Union, some of the largest data sets. And certainly their data sets, unfortunately, in the Soviet bloc country, they have population parameters data sets in the sense that if studies were to be done and you were asked to be a participant, you showed up. So they have large data sets on population, but also large data sets on elite athletes because they used this information to train. During Soviet bloc country, they viewed, and many of the communist countries of, or extreme socialist countries of old, they saw the Olympics as a place of improving them politically. So they invested energy, time, and science into understanding this. So if you think about DC potential, it's a slow regulatory system that tells us more about what is available to the brain related to brain, attention, coordination, to precision, communication, quality of movement, and most importantly, as we know, that the brain appreciates efficiency because it takes so much energy to run it. And so really measuring this allows us a deeper dive along with those other measures I mentioned, and by no means were those everything that can be done depending upon the question. As I said, I work as a practitioner, but it's usually from a standpoint of very much a research perspective, gathering subjective and objective data. If we look at the super slow regulatory system of the brain, it really touches a number of areas which validate its use, but again, not its use in solely, in the sense of that we need to gather, to understand an individual, a number of bits of information, subjective and objective. What is often forgotten is the brain. And even when we think about learning, going back to an environment that all of us know very much, how much time is really invested in understanding the neuroscience of education, whether it be environment and or whether it be trying to reach the individual in a way that is impactful. And then looking at industry, how much time is spent in these areas? To answer the question, very little. Henry Ford and you know, the industrial complex, if you will, and the assembly line, and we've taken it to other environments that are not fitting. But when we look at DC potential, also to tell you a little bit about the test, it requires two places of putting contact to gain information, which is the forehead, and grounding the signal on the hand. And so when we're looking at that, it's a very simple thing to do. And when we calculate data over time, a repeated measure, we're looking at it's about 7 minutes at each time. You can even do this measurement in between workload. So if an individual is moving from station to station, applying certain forces, whether it be neuromuscular, you know, stimulation, whether it be endurance stimulation, whether it be an open field type play. Again, this can be done in academic environments and industry where you have breaks. You can see what the level of adaptation is. So it's a very, and at the same time, gaining other biometric information. It's a very, very easy thing to gain from. Going back to the story of the cosmonauts, well, they had to be able to find a way to measure this that was simple. So we're not looking at EEG, full caps. And in fact, if we look at the EEG research on human performance, there is some consensus, but not very much. And because they're now accounting for variability, the uniqueness of athletes and performers, uniqueness from all of us. If we look also at DC potential, again, it hides itself in the peer review literature and the number of areas that we can find where it is being utilized, validated, or found to be efficacious and safe for medical environments and certainly sports and certainly psychophysiology. And yet, there's very little that I see of people utilizing this measure in sport, but in other environments. One of the things I will say, and I can talk about it a little bit if questions about my work with the elite military, but I won't ever talk about anything I can't, but they're 25 years ahead of sport because we've applied a brain first model using metrics, and certainly from the brain first. And then that makes those other metrics I mentioned much more powerful to understand the individual. What can they handle today? And what can they handle tomorrow? But more importantly, that the athlete or performer becomes self-guided by the signals. And again, that's really, I think, where the potential is here. It's not that we hold data about a person, as they become more informed about their variability. And how do I work with that? So this leads to, really, when we look at CNS readiness, leads to resilience and our ability to be resilient. Another thing that certainly flies in the face of mental toughness and grit, you know, they hold very little validity, and grit was conflated into sport but was not even proven in education, is that we are wired with the greatest survival system in the known universe. So we are all resilient. And that's why I stated earlier, this is not extraordinary. It's actually quite ordinary. But it's teaching people about how to use CNS signaling to understand behaviors that allow for enhanced recovery, which leads to resilience, which leads to adaptation. Going back to a parallel that in an earlier slide where I've talked about the environment in North American sport, more is better as opposed to better is better or better process is better. We can see the same in academics. We can see the same in industry. That the Japanese, and we can see it elsewhere, have a word for working to death called karoshi, is an example of how we are working beyond or not even acknowledging the central nervous system signaling about how to move towards resilience through rest and recovery, which is really a central nervous system derived concept. But let's look at resilience. Where did this idea come from? And I'm looking at the definition. It's not the psychological definition. It's the neurophysiological definition. Again, as a psychologist, I struggle at times when our definitions do not apply to understand the underlying process. And for me, that's why I respect physics and mathematics and certainly, you know, wanting to understand that underlying process. But resilience really came from the literature of trying to understand acute stress and PTSD. We can get into another time why I don't necessarily like those diagnostic categories because they don't describe the underlying process. However, what this line of research, what came out of it was starting the unique question, or the inspirational question, if you will, about why doesn't everyone acquire what we would call acute stress or PTSD? That is a fascinating question. That people who have been in war-torn countries involved with neglect in pre-verbal ages and verbal ages, that have been in traumatic situations like fires or vicarious trauma, you know, victims, if you will, as paramedics, firefighters, police, and then military, and yet they do not experience what we would categorize as. And that line of research led to this understanding that it was things they were doing about their recovery, things they were doing to modulate their autonomic nervous system, things that they were doing to apply factors so the brain had less fatigue. And again, they're not extraordinary, but they are impactful. So some of this line of research came out with, and again, some of this comes from skills that people had learned in transition to another environment. They had been in similar environments and had had the opportunity to figure out what worked for them. They had gone through some formal education about how to maintain the autonomic nervous system, the central nervous system under pressure. Very similar training that we see now for pilots and surgeons. If you ever want to see something or hear something of a high performance state is listening to the FAA video that you can find online, as well as 60 Minutes, a TV show here in the US, that relates to Sully Sullenberger landing the plane on the Hudson. And he was trained to monitor and manage his central nervous system, his autonomic nervous system. His voice never cracks. He had 5 seconds to make the decision to really help hundreds of people on the plane. And so these dynamics can be taught. And they're certainly a part of what we're teaching now, people who can gain vicarious trauma through military or tactical environments, but also sport, again, sports trauma. So what they discovered was one of the things is that people would, you know, really try to solidify their sleep. Sleep is our number one performance enhancer. And we know even from a concussion standpoint, if we cannot get people to sleep within the first 72 hours, that the prognosis is much worse, because what do we know? The lymphatic system in the brain cleans itself, it heals. All the other 11 systems come on board, which connects to tau protein, and those channels cleaning themselves. The other thing we saw was a stabilization in their appetite and working hard to create stimulus in the gut-brain axis, so we are producing proper neurotransmission. Also, hydration status. All these things have an impact on all the systems, but especially the central nervous system. And then lastly, finding that many people figured out to regulate or were spontaneously regulating the respiration rate. And we do know from HRV training that individuals that can regulate their breath rate control is certainly mitigate many of the things that relate to trauma, or what we call at times stress. And so when they've even looked, and this is not sufficient, certainly objective measures, we need to dig more in this, they saw certainly a very different scan of how a brain responds and their regular ability to cope. And as we know, you know, blood flow in certain areas describes competency to some degree. And so what they've discovered in these early research, and there's still more, and we need more, that's highlighting in individuals who have found themselves to be able to be resilient in environments that we would find much higher populations of acute stress and PTSD. And so in the environments I've worked in, the team science approach, we're looking at sport in this way. It is trauma. If we look at some sports like rugby, American football, ice hockey, you're looking at collisions that equivalent to small car crashes. Some go beyond that. If we look at elite military, we're looking at their explosion. The explosion penetrates central nervous system tissue very, very differently. And so it's even more impactful on the central nervous system in a negative fashion. Then we look at just industry jobs and the shock forces that are going through individuals. So these are factors that could be looking at to protect talent. Another factor within the military is being on certain weapon systems, you're acquiring shock waves that'd be the equivalent of playing a full season of rugby or ice hockey or American football. And so that's just being on that system for a certain number of hours. So we had to find a way to protect talent and use team size to do that. This is what I was referring to before, is this is the model we've worked from. The readiness is about daily behaviors that stabilize the central nervous system. Again, not extraordinary, quite ordinary, but often we overlook the power that these behaviors have to preserve individuals' ability. And there's individual variance in between that. To give an example, we would test often when people would go do a float. So if you're unfamiliar with floating is a sensory deprivation experience where you're floating in about 10 inches of high content of salt. You're lying on your back. There's very little sound. There is no light. And, you know, you're often in there for 30 minutes to an hour. And we would be looking at the central nervous system response as well as biometrics from cardiac system, HRV, things of that nature. And people will have different responses to that. So we would go through different recovery strategies and see what was the most impactful on the central nervous system and the autonomic nervous system. So it's a bespoke process to the performer as opposed to one size fits all. But also we would do the same for nutrition. We are often doing one size fits all in nutrition. The nutritionist I have the great pleasure of working with have a great respect for the neuroscience and the neuroanatomy. And we're, again, doing blood, urine, and fecal to understand the individual much better. And can we use, and we all know that their research is going out more and more in this area, can we use food to stabilize gut-brain access, the bacteria, and neurotransmission? And we know we can. And a lot more we need to know, but we know we can there. So looking at their daily habits and then finding a cycle that fits not necessarily ideals, but it's flexible enough to meet chaos, nonlinear dynamic. And so that leads to that resilience, that compounding process over time, which leads to adaptation. Really, this model pulls a lot from looking at Gerald Edelman's work in neurodarwinism, in that our survival is based upon our system, but also variation. So attending to those factors, but bringing them down to actionable things that are measured to the individual. And again, I don't believe sports is the only environment this can be done. Again, tackle environments and certainly industry, and I think education is missing some of these points. To give a point from a, again, bringing it close, because I don't know if I'm the only person from sport involved in this, but I'm an academic as well, is are we really looking at the transition in an academic career and applying the understanding of the individual to help with that transition? Some of the things we can see in the U.S. and around the world, there's veterans returning to school. Are we providing a readiness cycle for that transition and individual variation? Are we doing that for our first-year students? So I think we can be doing a better job for that, to protect talent and develop that, as opposed to a sink or swim sort of approach. And the last thing that really this model of variation is built upon is also something that is not talked about in much in science more over the last 10 years, but hormetic dosing, that anything can be poison. It depends upon the dose. So in sport, we call it dose training. It could be endurance training, it could be strength training, it could be speed training. It could be open field pattern recognition training. A lot of ways, but we can apply that in learning, and we can apply that in career development in industry. So hormesis, every living thing has this, but often we are not looking at the dose related to how the brain responds. So we're making assumptions, but the hormetic dose is a biphasic response that every living thing has. That if we dose small amounts of stimulus, that we build up a beneficial adaptation, which then advances learning or adaptation in a faster way when we then reintroduce that training environment, that new stimulus, that learning, that coordinated effort to advance in some skill level. But instead, what we often do is we overdose, which throws off hormetic process, our central nervous system, and then the other 11 systems. So a part of the model was also titrating the dose. So an easy way to think about this is, I can remember, and many people maybe listening can, that when we got a flu shot, if you're as old as me or older, it had some of the flu in it. It no longer does, but that is hormetic dosing. And hormetic dosing protects talent. It also allows us to develop it more evenly. It also allows us to develop it individually. Give another example from sport. When you are measuring from the central nervous system and the other systems, and then you go out for practice, training, we may have three practices going on at once because of the readiness. The central nervous system shows fatigue, so those individuals are going to do what we would call a passive or active recovery session. Again, trying to create rejuvenation and increase the energy within the brain, and certainly reference points of how it pulls glycogen stores from the body and so on and so forth. We might have a group that is really doing a low dose active training, but we're measuring it so we know when to pull them. So we got to pull you. You're getting too close to being overtrained or overstretched. And then we'll have a group that is fully available to be training that day with a particular dose. And so this is completely applicable to other environments as well. Readiness matters, and that is only derived from the CNS. So that's a little bit about kind of the approach that I've been lucky enough to work in a team science environment. So I really want to thank everyone for, listening to that, and I hope I was able to give relatable things, not just focused on sport, because I think, life outside of sport teaches sport a lot when it's involved in a culture, and sport, teaches culture. I think there's examples on both sides of that and opportunities on both sides.